Cherringham, Episode 20, Follow the Money. Written by Matthew Costello and Neil Richards. Narrated by Neil Dudgeon.
Chapter 1. The Party's Over. Claire Goodman looked over at her husband Terry and wished she could give him a quick nudge under the table. Here they were at this completely lovely dinner party at the Edwards house, and he sat there, shirt sleeves rolled up, with his elbows on the table. Elbows on the table! She had told him that he simply had to wear a tie. After all, this was a proper dinner party. So he did at least have a tie around his neck. But he'd loosened the knot the minute they'd sat down to eat, and now he looked like he was out for beers with his mates. Claire so wanted to make a good impression. They had moved to Cherringham only a year ago, when Terry relocated his luxury car dealership from West London to just outside the village. Claire had thrown herself into so many village activities, she felt as if she had finally arrived. Unfortunately, she had arrived with a husband who, though unquestionably doing well financially, didn't realise that this was the Cotswolds, a place for more refined behaviour, a place of beauty and class, she thought. She'd grown up in East London in a 60s tower block which she couldn't leave fast enough. Living here, in their beautiful home on the new and expensive development just outside the village with river frontage, was like living in a style magazine. She looked around the table to gauge everyone's reaction to Terry, pontificating as usual about anything and everything. The vicar, Reverend Hewitt, nodded. His sweet, shy wife, Emily, still fiddled with her pudding. Will Goodchild, the village historian, and now there was a man who was fascinating to listen to, rubbed his cheek. I bet he's thinking, hope this man stops talking. And Roger Reed, the head of the Oratorio Society and director of the upcoming opera-themed concert. Roger seemed intent on keeping his wine glass at nothing less than half full. Bit of a tippler. And Helen and Michael Edwards? They had been perfect hosts. The dinner had been fabulous. Cornish game hens with a delicious rosemary sauce. The white wine perfectly matched, crisp, delicious. And the pudding, a creamy lemon sorbet that Helen said she had made herself with some help from a TV chef, was to die for.
"What do you think, Reverend?" Terry said.
"Hmm?" the vicar said.
"This Europe nonsense, in, out, or none of the above. Can't see the Eurozone's doing my business any good, all that red tape." Then a barrel laugh, so gauche. "Not that I'm hurting at all. If you have to sell luxury cars, there's no better place than right here in the Cotswolds."
Reverend Hewitt smiled. His eyes drifted to Claire as if signalling he understood her discomfort.
"I think, Terry, that will be for the voters to decide."
"Hmm?"
Another laugh from her husband at that. "And so God hasn't whispered to you his thoughts on the way things might go?"
The vicar smiled again. Such a gentle, kind man, who clearly could suffer fools and dinner guests with grace and aplomb. Then Michael stood up, as if to break the thread of all this political tattle.
"Well, I have a rather decent port for us to try."
Michael poured the port slowly into delicate crystal glasses that caught the flickering light of the candles on the table. Then he made a toast.
"To friends."
And the port so good, smooth, silky. But she saw Terry knock it back as if it was a shot of Bell's. Michael quickly poured him another, though everyone else was still savouring theirs. Helen turned to Reverend Hewitt and his wife.
"And Vicar, Emily, have you heard what big plans we have for our winter concert?"
Claire beamed. That's how she met Helen, how they became friends over a shared love of singing and opera. Finally, she had someone to talk to about all that. No, Roger here has been very secretive about plans. Helen looked right at Claire. Cat out of the bag time, Roger said. We could not be more excited. The theme this year is Verdi's heroines. Helen continued, and both Claire and I will be doing solos on the night.
Can't wait, Terry said, as if proud of his rudeness.
Claire jumped in quickly. Helen will be singing Sempre Libera from La Traviata, and I'll be doing the Willow song. From Otello, Will Goodchild said. Wonderful. Perhaps my favourite of the entire Verdi canon. Semi-staged, of course, Roger Reed said. I want to make sure we have a bit of drama along with the wonderful singing. And the chorus will have their work cut out for them, Claire said. Doing everything from Va Pensiero from Nabucco to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.